Hello everyone, welcome to my house. My name is Maarten Breddels and I'm going to talk about remote data frames and interactive exploration of big astronomical data sets with VEX. This work is funded by the Hysing-Simon Foundation and done in collaboration with Joshua Peak and Sergei Kopasov. So let's discuss what the main problem is. In and outside of astronomy, we have big or at least uncomfortably big data. And an example of that is Gaia DR2, and that's a data set we're going to explore during this presentation. So Gaia DR2, visualized here, is a full sky survey of our Milky Way, and it contains 1.7 billion rows or stars and 95 columns. In total, it's over 1 terabyte of data. And you could download that. That would take you probably more than a day. So it's doable, but it doesn't really fit so well on your laptop. It's maybe difficult to process. There are other ways. You can use SQL or ADQL interfaces, but they're limited in scope. They don't have a Python API that you may like, or it's it may be too slow for custom filtering and aggregation. And this problem is only going to increase. There are similar data sets of similar sizes, Penstars, WISE, TwoMass, and in the future, LSST is going to increase this by a factor of 10. So this problem is also something that Sergei and Joshua thought of, and they wrote a proposal called Data at Your Fingertips, a real-time discovery engine for Gaia. And what they proposed is a system to query n-dimensional histograms and allowing you to define custom filterings that would. And with these 1 or 2D histograms, you will be able to visualize the full Gaia dataset. And doing that in a notebook environment will be easy to share with colleagues, especially with Voila, what I'm going to show, to show dashboards to each other. And so they had this plan, wrote a proposal, and then Alyssa Goodman actually put us in contact because she realized that half of this was already implemented in VEX. So that led to a collaboration between me, Sergei, and Joshua. And that's basically what we're going to show today. So what is VEX? So it's a out-of-core data frame library for Python. And just to give you an idea, it can process about 1 billion rows per second. No need for a cluster, for the Gaia dataset at least. Out-of-core means that it can work with this 1 terabyte data set without having 1 terabyte of memory. You can just pip or uninstall it, so one command and you have it. And it has a data frame API, so it's really Pandas-like. There's also a remote data frame API, so actually a pip install and one command, and you should be connected to the full Gaia dataset. So there's been an article out recently comparing VEX to or various data frame solutions, or and VEX is doing really well. Like some of the examples, benchmarks, it's 15 times faster than the main competitors, and in some extreme case, 800. And most of that can be attributed to being, really memory efficient. But to really understand what VEX is, I think it's good to give you a demo in a notebook. And we're going to work with the Gaia DR2 dataset. I'm going to show some key features, focus on visualization. I may do a Voila intro. So let's zoom in a bit. So first about the computer we're using. We're not using my desktop because it's running the video capture software. So this is a quite powerful machine, but we're just going to use 8 cores today, representative for a powerful laptop. Has a lot of RAM, but actually it doesn't matter in what we're going to do today. Just to give you an idea about the cost, $5,000 for a machine we're running on now. So I think that's in budget for most astronomy departments. This whole notebook you can find, so you don't have to type it in yourself. So just some basics. Let's take a look at the data set. Stored in HCFI format, pretty standard file format. 1.2 terabyte, that's pretty big. So that may take a while to open. 112 milliseconds. 19 milliseconds. So as you can see, it's pretty fast in opening this because it's only memory mapping the 1.7 billion rows, 95 columns. So it gives you just a preview of the data. It's not loading it into memory directly. So one of the most important things of Gaia is basically sky coordinates and parallax and proper motions, of course. Parallax being the most difficult, one of the most difficult to measure. So you can get the distance from the parallax by inverting it. As you see, it's really fast, 24 milliseconds to compute this because it's not really computing it. It won't occupy more than 10 gigs calculating this the distance. It just calculates an expression. And it gives you a preview of the value. So you, from this, you can already see that one of the values is missing. And these are in kiloparsecs. So you get some idea about the distance and you see negative distances. You can add an expression to a data frame. We call that a virtual column. So these are real column. They're like on disk. And now we have a new column. Doesn't take any memory. But you can use it as a normal column. So let's see, what can we do? A lot of the things you do with the data set size is about aggregation. So simple aggregations are like calculating a mean of a column, in this case, the distance. So what it's doing in chunks, it's calculating the distance on the fly, in chunks and adding this all together in the end. And you see the negative distance isn't really physical, which is caused by uncertainty in the parallax. So usually you have a filter like this. You see parallax over error smaller, greater than 3. But you may be worried that this would copy the data. So copying the 1.2 terabyte data doesn't seem like a smart idea. So instead, what VEX does, it just keeps a mask of all the rows that satisfy this condition and references the original data. So you see we now have over 250 million, million rows. And on this, we can compute a real physical mean distance. All statistical arguments, statistical function take an argument called bin by, and that's basically say, give me bins, in this case, 100 bins between magnitude of 5 and 20, and calculate in each bin the mean distance. So you get a NumPy array, and so we don't look at numbers, so we probably want to visualize this, so you can use your favorite plotting library, Matplotlib in this case. But you see you lose the axis information. This is just a bin number, not the G magnitude. There are several ways to do this. You can do this yourself, of course. What I really like is this library called X-Array, which we support. So if you say, give me an X-Array instead of a NumPy array, you get a richer data structure called an X-Array data array that has the original NumPy array in it, but also includes the coordinates of these values. And with that information, it can create a much more meaningful plot. But as you see, this is pretty noisy. Like, I don't know why this peak is here. So let's reorganize this a bit. So we probably want to do some filtering. What you do in VEX or can do in VEX is doing selections. So I'm doing the same as what I've done before, but now saying, give me a selection where parallax of error greater than 1, 3, and 10. And now we get a two-dimensional array where one axis is the selection, the other axis is the G mean magnitude. So we have, and inside of this data structure is the information of what it means. And now we can use the, if you go to the X-Array documentation, you can give this U argument, and basically it's coloring the lines according to the selection axis, and automatically giving you a legend. Of course, this is Gaia, full sky. So one mandatory thing is to show a plot of the sky. This doesn't look so good. We need to transpose it, it seems. L and B are like flipped. And unfortunately, the galactic center is in split in half. And also plotting it in log, it gives a much better contrast. So you see the LMC and SMC here. But all these plots are static. And what we want, we are in a notebook, and there are lots of interactive tools, plotting libraries, widget libraries, and we want to connect to that. So we want to redraw, re-execute code. When, for instance, a selection changes, we want to connect to IPyWidget and IPyFutify, some of the libraries built on top of IPyWidgets. We also provide some base widget for dashboarding with Voila. And one of the least interesting things, actually, but most of the work is dealing with the async updating, canceling, calculations, scheduling, debouncing them, and basically details you don't want to know about. So one of the building blocks of this library is the access object. It is an object that is basically wraps what you pass in the binby arguments. So this is binby distance with 64 bins between 0 and 30. And you can pass this object, this access object, to the data array method. And then it will create a data array widget. So this is an interactive version of the data array. So it basically prints out the data array, and it recomputes it if you change something on the access object. So I now change the maximum of this object. So I can print this object out again. Well, it's the max is 30. And you can see that here, these are the centers of the bin. So this is updated. Again, we don't look at numbers so much. We mostly do visualization. So instead of having a simply displaying this X-Array data, you can provide a custom function, and this one would just plot it. And now we have a plot of the counts in distance, basically a histogram of distance. And again, if we change the maximum, it will compute all the grids and it will update the figure. Maybe we want to take a look at the log distance and do a cut on parallax. And we again do the U. We color according to the selection, and we do all the data and the selection I created here. So now you see you have two plots with just a minimum amount of code, and all of this is interactive. For instance, now I realize that the log should have been log base 10. So I change the expression. It will compute the min-max, calculate the grid. Okay, maybe I want to zoom in. And every time it will compute for you on the background the data to make your visualization. Maybe you want to change the selection. And in the case of a dashboard environment using Voila, you don't have access to the code cells, so you want to have some kind of widget to be able to change what the selection is. So we provide some basic widget so that you don't have to do all the plumbing. Using these building blocks, you can use like interactive libraries like BQplot to create an interactive histogram. So in this case, this is using BQplot, so we can zoom in and zoom out, and it will rebin the data. And let's do another histogram. And now all these histograms are linked. So if I do a selection here, so I say I want to have like all this data, this histogram will be recomputed, but also this one. But also if you have a heat map, so this is also using BQplot, this is also showing the selection, so we see a bright spot here. So this has a large parallax over error, so it has a well-determined distance. So we could probably zoom in, select this, and estimate a distance. But I want to do like let you do this. So what I'm going to do is I want to create a dashboard. Last year we gave a talk at SciPy about Voila and Futify, so I'm gonna just give you the idea of what Voila can do. So we now have a notebook here. We're just gonna import Vex again and open the data frame. We can print some statistics, make the heat map and a histogram, and we wanna, instead of having all the code visible here, we want to start making a dashboard. So from the command line, what we can do is run Voila, and we just want to grab the extensions locally, not from a CDN, and run this notebook. So what happens now is that Voila will run your notebook, but it will not show the code. It will render the markdown. It will render the all the outputs of the cells. And this is already looking like more friendly for just doing data exploration. You don't in the case where you don't want to see the code. But there are two issues here. One is this is running on this computer, and we want to share this with someone, and we want to put this on MyBinder. But if we do this, we run into a problem. And the problem is that this data set, this 1.2 terabyte data set, cannot be transported to MyBinder in an instant. So that's a bit of a problem. So that brings us to topic of remote data frames. And so it's been a trend to bring the computer the data, which makes sense, and that's really natural in the notebook. You just go to a particular computer, feed a browser, and you can compute where the data is. Another way is to use a system like Dask, where you basically have a Python environment, say in the cloud or somewhere near the data that runs your code. But both of these allow for arbitrary code execution. Instead, Vex is using a data frame server, and that's kind of useful for where you when you don't want the application code to run on the same server as where the data is being crunched. So maybe you have your laptop and you have your local Jupyter environment set up, or maybe you don't use Jupyter at all and you prefer to use your local editor, and you just want to connect to the data source, do some aggregations and do your data analysis or visualization on your laptop. For our use case, we actually we want to run Voila in the cloud on MyBinder. And we cannot make it run on the same computer because we're not giving you a Voila access or any way to run Voila on the Vex data frame server. So the two data frame servers now running. This is running on AWS. This is our own server, the same computer that that we're running this on. So let me show you. So we go to dataframe.vex.io. We see a list of data frames here. So this is the Gaia dataset. We copy it here. Go back to our notebook, and we're actually going to go to a more fancier notebook. And again, these are some background resources that you can use. And instead of using the local data file, we're going to use this what we copied from the website. So now this is our data frame path. So what is this object? So it's also a data frame, remote. So the data lives somewhere remote, but it feels like a normal data frame. Like you can do almost everything with this this data frame as you can do with as if you had your data local. So you can add a virtual column, the distance, you can compute on that. So now it will do the aggregation at the server, and it will just transport the aggregated data. And every time it sends what the virtual columns are also to the server. So now we can have our widgets, such as our heat map with the remote data frame. So all the things we've done before, we can do with this remote data frame. I'm not going to go through it. If you go through the tutorial on Vex Jupyter, it will explain this a bit more, but we're basically gonna create some widgets and connect widgets such that we can control what's on the x-axis. So I can control here what the x-axis is. So I can say it should be RA. And as we saw in voila here, It's nice that you don't see the code, but this you have to scroll, and it doesn't look like a real dashboard. And if you go through our talk of last year, we'll show how to do that with voila Futrify. So I'm just gonna make a few pretty what are called cards. So just to give it a title to make it look a bit neater. So same for the histogram. Putting it on a card, and then we're going to put it in a container such that they're nicely aligned. And another widget to create and go through your columns. And now, if we run voila for this notebook, but with a different template. Futrify default. We get a different spinner already in the Futrify look. And now we get our full app. And we can, and it's responsive. So if I change the size, it should collapse this, etc. So this also works on smaller screens, on your tablet actually, or your phone. It should also work, but you can't access it because it's still on localhost. So let's, how do we get this running in the cloud? So I made this repo on GitHub, where we put the notebook that we just saw, a small configuration file just to say that we want to have the Futrify template requirements for the dependencies, the Python dependencies that we need, some Vex packages, voila Futrify. If you want to do debugging in the notebook, this is required, and this version of BQplot. So let's close this. Now we go to my binder. And we copy paste the URL of the GitHub repo. Then we change this to URL. And then we can launch it. If you click here, you can copy paste some markdown to generate a link to run this. That's what we did here. So you can go on your mobile phone to this repo, click on launch binder, and then on the cloud, it's now connecting to the DataFrame server. And now we're going to do some science with this. So let's filter on this parallax over error. And then we were interested in the distance of this object here. So you see that every time that I zoom in, it cancels the calculation, the previous one, does the new one, not to waste resources. So this should give us a good field of view. We logically combine the two filters and hopefully get a good distance estimate. We need to normalize, and now you see that we have a peak at a particular distance, and this happens to correspond to the distance of this object. I think it's M67. So, to give you a summary, I've shown you FEX, consists of several packages, the FEX cores, the data frame part that does the really fast processing. FEX Jupyter makes the connection to Jupyter and widgets, and voila. FEX server gives you the remote data frame such that you can have a data frame server, a powerful machine, and other computers that consume the aggregated data and create dashboards using, in this case I've shown Voila, but you could use Dash, Panel, or whatever you think is best. I've shown you Voila. Voila makes it really easy to take your notebook and turn it into a you could say a report or a dashboard, and with IPy Futify and Voila Futify, you can actually make like really modern looking dashboards. So you could summarize this saying that FEX plus Voila creates, with FEX and Voila, you can create interactive dashboards for big data sets without a cluster. Some future plans, depends a bit of the on the funding. But we hope to get some more examples, some example notebooks for using this Gaia dataset, some widgets to make it more easy as building blocks to make dashboards, allowing for remote joins and group buys that need some refactoring. And together with that, we should be able to also implement distributed data frames that could run on Dask or Ray. And then you should be able to scale up FEX to 10 to the 10th, so 10 billion or 10 to the 12th, trillion rows. Another exciting package that I worked on is Glue or Glue Jupyter that takes interactive data exploration in Jupyter to the max. And it would be really nice if we can integrate better in that. And if you see this project, you see cross-pollination between the two projects. And I want to leave you with these resources. So there's some more notebooks here. most of the packages for GitHub, some documentation that's useful, and feel free to contact us if you have questions or if you want to collaborate. Thank you very much.